scripture on its head a bit this morning. The way this story is usually preached or told is to focus on the fact that Jesus broke the rules by healing someone on the Sabbath, especially since it wasn't an emergency situation that required tending to on a traditional day of rest. I would like to focus on the woman. This woman had been in pain for 18 years, and she asked for help. I assure you, after 18 years of pain, this was an emergency for the woman. Jesus saw her pain, and instead of telling her to come back another day, he healed her. He ended her suffering. But this healing couldn't have happened if the woman, on the Sabbath, hadn't come to him and asked for help. She advocated for herself and her health, and her self-advocacy was rewarded, even on the Sabbath. She was both brave and vulnerable, and that bravery and vulnerability led to her healing. She came to be healed, to be changed, to be whole, and she did that on the Sabbath. This woman suffered from chronic pain, 18 years of chronic pain. Modern studies have shown that chronic pain can increase blood pressure and heart rate. It can affect the immune system and increase risk for heart disease. People who suffer from chronic pain can have muscle problems, limited mobility, depression, anger, anxiety. Living with chronic pain means that sometimes you need help getting dressed, that you can only do one big thing a day, or that you can't sleep well because you're never quite comfortable at night. It also means that healthcare providers might not take you seriously, or that an injury can go untreated for weeks or months because you didn't realize you were actually injured. On top of that, women's pain is less likely to be taken seriously than men's. In fact, a woman in pain might wait 50% longer to be treated in an emergency situation, if she is treated. Women's pain is often perceived as imagined or exaggerated. And in fact, women are more likely to be treated less aggressively in their initial encounters with the healthcare system until they prove that they're as sick as the male patients. And if that woman happens to be a person of color, or someone for whom English isn't a first language, the weight and the struggle will be amplified further. Now, I don't have any concept of what healthcare looked like in Jesus' day, but my guess is that this woman's pain was also dismissed or ignored. She was probably written off as crazy, or as deserving of the pain as some sort of punishment for perceived sin. I don't know for sure. What I do know is that her pain was so bad that she dragged herself out of her home and down to where Jesus was speaking, to be healed, to be changed, to be made whole. And she did that on the Sabbath. Now, I know kind of how she felt. I have fibromyalgia and deal with chronic pain. On most days, I live at about a 6 on the 0 to 10 pain scale. But on some days, I can't function at all. I know what it feels like to come home from work and have no energy left to do anything. I know what it feels like to have an injury, but be told, oh, that's just your fiber, rather than someone ordering an x-ray or an MRI. So I understand how this woman might have felt, and I can certainly imagine what it took for her to flag down Jesus for much needed healing. Have you heard of something called spoon theory? Anyone? So this is a concept coined by Christine Mizurenda. And here's the basic idea. Every day, everyone starts with a certain amount of spoons. So let's say 12. And for a person without chronic pain or illness, getting out of bed in the morning and preparing for the day might take 1 spoon, leaving 11, if it takes any. For someone with chronic illness, it might take 2 to get out of bed, another 2 to put on clothes, another 2 to fix their hair, or make up, or brush their teeth. And that leaves only 6 and they haven't even left the house. Working costs spoons. Running errands costs a few more. It's possible to get home and not have enough left to prepare dinner, much less eat it. For some folks, going to bed and getting rest may not replenish their strength at all. They may wake up the next day with only 10. And it's only Tuesday, and they have the rest of the week to get through. So sometimes a person with a chronic illness doesn't have enough spoons to do something like wash the dishes, take a shower, or even go to church. I imagine that this is what it was like for the woman in our story. She was in pain and out of spoons, and no one would help her. And it was the Sabbath. And the one person who just might be able to help her happened to be in town. So she found the strength to go see Jesus. And instead of just dismissing her and saying, "Sorry, I can't help you today, it's the Sabbath," Jesus healed her on the Sabbath because there was no excuse for continuing to let her suffer. He knew he could help her, and rather than adhere to the law, he helped her. Sometimes the needs of others transcend the law. This makes me think about people who have gotten in trouble for doing things like adding quarters to a parking meter, or the woman who was arrested for handing out cold water at the border. The needs of others transcend the law in these moments. I think of cancer patients who have purchased cannabis illegally. Their need for relief transcended the law. And yes, I realize this is a slippery slope, and there's a fine line between you and ones, and that laws are laws for a reason. But religious law. No one would be harmed by Jesus' healing on the Sabbath. No one's business would suffer loss. The only harm that could have been caused in this moment would be from ignoring the woman's cry for help. And Jesus understood that. In the case of the Sabbath, compassion overrides rest. Let's return our focus to the woman again. She was in a position where she had to advocate for herself. No one approached Jesus on her behalf. No one sent for Jesus to go to her home. She had to find the strength to get out of bed, struggle across town, and approach him directly. She was her own advocate. Life with chronic pain is like that. You have to fight for an MRI because you know that some pain feels different than the regular pain. You have to remind the doctors that one diagnosis isn't called to cover all of your symptoms, and your disease isn't a scapegoat for anything else that might have come up. You have to read a lot. You have to know which medical and non-medical interventions have been used with success, and which ones are money-grabbing farce. Does this supplement or that one actually work? Someone just trying to take my money? Has the doctor heard of this latest study on your disease? Will your insurance cover this treatment? Just keeping up with the research costs you spoons you don't have to begin with. I imagine that after 18 years, this woman knew what worked for her and what didn't. She had likely tried every other possible treatment and cure available to her at the time. There are those who would argue that what was ailing the woman was Satan, or her spirit, or that she was bit over with shame or sin. I think that's too easy. I think it's much too easy to try to place the blame on the person who was hurting. And yet, studies have shown that our feelings for empathy for others may depend on the extent to which we may or may not believe that they're responsible for their suffering. Surely this woman had done something to deserve the pain. Surely she had brought it on herself. It's easy to believe that. And then believe that Jesus' healing of her is almost metaphorical, that he removed the burden of her sin. I just don't think of it that way. I can't believe that don't lose your pain as a punishment. I don't think God works that way. I don't think the people who suffer from chronic pain deserve it. And I sincerely believe that Jesus helped this woman to overcome her pain. She came to him to be healed on the Sabbath, and he healed her. He changed her. He made her whole on the Sabbath. And then I wonder how many people come to church on Sunday for the same reason, to be healed, to be changed, to be made whole. They struggle for the week, and Sunday, the day they can finally rest and reset for the week. And instead, they show up in buildings like this, seeking wholeness and healing. Do they get it? Or do they leave wondering if they are worthy of healing and help? Are churches helping, or are they adding to the suffering? In Luke 10:27, he reminds us that we are to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. And following this law meant that Jesus had to heal this woman on the Sabbath. Loving his neighbor meant loving this woman and healing her on the Sabbath. The law of love transcends all others. Love is the answer here. Love is what ultimately healed this woman and released her from 18 years of pain. Now maybe we aren't Jesus, but we are Jesus followers, and our love has the power to help others. How do you love a neighbor with chronic pain? Well, hold your judgments. It's really easy to judge someone with chronic pain and to assume that they're lazy, or that because they're walking just fine, they don't need an accessible parking spot. Just because a person doesn't look sick doesn't mean that they are healthy. Folks with chronic pain get really good at masking their pain, saving their tears for when no one is watching, or giving all they've got at work and then coming home like crashing in private. Loving someone with chronic pain means believing that the pain is there and holding back judgment. Unless you are that person's medical or mental health professional, don't offer advice. I assure you, someone with chronic pain has heard every possible answer. Exercise more, don't exercise, go gluten-free, try keto, try CBD, try this supplement. You can only get it at XYZ store. Have you tried yoga? Yes, they've tried, and they've heard it all. And hearing it again and again is exhausting. Loving someone with chronic pain means not trying to be their doctor. Don't isolate or exclude them because you know they won't show up. One of the hardest things about suffering from a chronic illness is the isolation from friends and family. What's worse is that the pain can be predictable. So they might initially say, yes, I can absolutely be with it. But on the day, they don't have the students left to participate. When you do invite them out, please assure them that the invitation is not binding and that you won't be mad if they have to back out. This will make your friend more likely to accept the invitation in the first place and more able to say, hey, I just can't today. It's a double gift. Loving someone with chronic pain and inviting them to things, even if you don't think they'll show up. And oh, be careful with touch. While Jesus' touch may have been miraculous, yours might not be. In fact, someone who suffers from chronic pain may experience a flare, bruising, nausea, or increased pain just from being touched. It doesn't take a lot to ask, hey, are you vulnerable today? And then respecting the answer. Loving someone with chronic pain means asking before touching. Offer tangible help. Your friend who suffers from chronic pain likely needs help that you can provide, but if you ask, what can I do to help? They probably won't answer. Here's some things you can do. I'm making a chicken tomorrow. Can I bring you some? I'm going to the grocery store tomorrow. Do you need anything? Milk? Coffee? Any other staples? I'm taking my kids to the park tomorrow. I'd love to take yours with me. I'm running a bunch of errands this afternoon. I can easily check some items off your list too. Do you need anything mailed? Picked up or dropped off with cleaners? The post office? I'm in the mood for some canine company. Can I walk your dog? You can also say things like, hey, I miss you. Can I bring a pizza to your house and we can watch a movie together? Or, the very best friends ask, I know you feel awful. Can I clean your kitchen? Can I toss a load in the laundry for you? Or even, let's have a pajama day. I'll bring lunch. Loving someone with chronic pain to be offering help in real, tangible ways. If we go back to the story, to Jesus and the woman in pain, we see that Jesus gave a really good example of how to treat someone. He believed her. He didn't judge. He didn't offer her a magic elixir. He didn't shame her for her ailment. He welcomed her. He made time for her. He loved her enough to heal the Sabbath. With his loving compassion, he changed her life. And with his love, he showed us how to care for others. To help them heal, to help them be changed, to help them feel